I woke up to devastating news this morning. Such a shock for anyone who knew her, let alone me, who was her friend. A 35-year-old poet, too young to die. Strange stories circulate about her death. The city elite believe she didn't die from natural causes. Parvin's brother said their autopsy request was rejected. The real cause of her death will never be known. There was talk of murder. I can't believe my dear Parvin isn't with us anymore. I was shattered. Parvin wasn't just a friend and companion. She was a gem of Persian literature, the like of whom we will never see again. At her peak, she would always consider the social implications and truth of her poems. How could anyone be indifferent to her death? I spoke to several poets and literary figures. I was supposed to write an article about the life and work of Parvin for the newspapers. To write it, I had to start by describing Parvin, who she was, and what it was about her that would make the government want her dead. Parvin E’tesami was born on the 16th of March 1907, the triumphant year of the constitutional revolution in Iran. Her father was one of the constitutionalists of Tabriz, a writer and translator and fluent in several languages. He had a printing house in Tabriz, where a magazine entitled Bahar, meaning spring, was published, and which supported constitutional ideals. Her mother, Akhtar al-Muluke Futuhi, was fond of literature and the arts. Parvin was five when her father was appointed a Member of Parliament for Tabriz for the second term. From that time on, she was surrounded and impacted by political talk of current affairs and the constant flow of politicians in and out of their home.
نظر من خط جدا کننده ای بود که میشه شعر زنان رو به ویژه به زمان پیش از پروین اعتصامی و پس از پروین اعتصامی به نحوی دستبندی کرد.
سخن ما درباره یکی از شاعران بزرگ تاریخ ادبیات ماست. ما در 14 قرن ادبیات خودمون و به خصوص در قلمرو شعر زنان شاعر شاخص و بزرگ کم نداشته ایم.
البته پروین باز هم متاثر از یعنی تلفیقی از سبک خراسانی و شعر سعدی، یعنی سبک عراقی و اون سلیس بودن، ساده و روان بودن شعر سعدیه.
به حدی ایشون آموزشی رو که از پدرشون دریافت میکردن به خوبی دریافت کردند و به کار بستند که به هر حال حاصلش شد اون چیزی که ما به عنوان پروین اعتصامی و به عنوان یک شاعر خاص به نظر من امروز میشناسیمشون. شاعری که استاد شفیع کتکنی درباره ایشون به عنوان معجزه پروین ازشون نام میبرن.
به سبب این که در کنار پدر بزرگ خودش زندگی میکنه و پدرش با زبانها آشناست، مترجمه، سرکار با مطبوعات داره، سروده ها را از زبان های گوناگون برای پروین ترجمه میکنه و پروین که خودش در مدرسه امریکایی درس خونده و در 18 سالگی فارغ التحصیل شده و تسلط زبانی داره، با اون ذوق سرشار و استعداد خدادادی که داره این سروده ها را به فارسی باز میگرداند و بعد تبدیل به شعر میکند.
شاعری که در دایره افراد ویژه قرار داره و افرادی که واقعا در میتونن نگاه اون رو تربیت کنند و پرورش بدن، بی تردید میتونه چنین رشدی در او اتفاق بیفته و چنین حاصلی رو به بار بیاره.
At the same time, her father was appointed head of the parliamentary library. This gave Parvin access to browse and read at will. Courtesy of her father, she had the privilege to be present at his meetings with legendary poets and literary figures, such as the poet laureate Muhammad Taghi Bahar, known as Malik al-Shu'aray Bahar, and Ali Akbar Dehkhoda, the prominent linguist, best known for his Persian dictionary.
به یقین پروین بعد از سال 1290 پا به مدرسه میگذاره و سالهای ابتدایی رو میگذرونه و بعد وارد مدرسه اوناسیه آمریکایی ها میشه و در اونجا دیپلم میگیره. در سال 1303، جوزای سال 1303 یعنی خرداد ماه، در اونجا فارغ التحصیل میشه. و نکته جالب توجه این است که بلافاصله در همون مدرسه شروع میکنه به تدریس و نقش معلم رو داره. اون چه که مسلمه این است که پروین در همون سالها شروع به سرایش شعر کرده.
In 1924 she graduated with honors. Her graduation speech was so articulate and impressive, it became known as the Lecture on Women and History. You could say it was one of the first steps towards the transformation of the status of women in Iranian society. In her speech, she proposed it was not necessary to become westernized, that education was the key to empower women in society. And this at a time when she herself had difficulty establishing herself as a female poet. After her graduation, Parvin began teaching English. At the same time, she mixed in literary circles where other poets became familiar with her work. Publishing her works in newspapers and magazines, including her father's publication, she soon became known for the clever political anecdotes in her poetic dialogue, and before long, with the encouragement of her peers, she found an audience.
و یکی از شعرهای بسیار ماندگار پروین اعتصامی که در 12 سالگی سروده شده از سروده هایی است که در کتاب های درسی فراوان استفاده شده و یکی از زیباترین کارهای پروین اعتصامی هم است. از ساحت پاک آشیانی مرغی بپرید سوی گلزار، در فکرت توشی و توانی افتاد بسی و جست بسیار. این شعر سرانجام به اینجا میرسه که این پرنده مورد هدف تیر صیاد قرار میگیره و پروین با اندوه و داغ و درد از این مسئله یاد میکنه و از همینجا پل میزنه به مسائل اجتماعی که نشان میدهد پروین از همون حدود 12 سالگی حساسیت های اجتماعی هم دارد و شعر او آینه و ترجمان رنج و درد مردم میشود.
شعر پروین گفتیم سهل و ممتنع و روانه و در واقع شعر تعلیمی اخلاقیه دیگه، یعنی این تصوف و عرفان ما، این اونچه که میراث صوفیه و عرفای ماست، او هم سعی کرده که تقریبا با زبان قصه و داستان اون تمثیل اون چیزهایی رو که میخواد از جهت اخلاقی و اینها پیاده بکنه.
با چنین افکار ژرف و شگرفی میتواند در اون دوران خودنمایی کنه. پروین اصلا اهل خودنمایی نبود، اما دیوان او باعث میشه که بسیاری از مردم روزگار خودش با افکار او و اشعار او که کاملا اجتماعی و مردمی بود آشنا بشند.
But with the fall of the constitutionalists of the Qajar dynasty and the rise of Reza Shah Pahlavi, The political atmosphere of the nation changed dramatically. With World War I, the occupation of Iran by the Russians and the British, and the following famine, Iran was in crisis. Reza Shah had closed down most of the newspapers to curb criticism of government policy.
حتی گاهی وقتا مثلا در مناظره دو قطره خون مثلا واژه کارگر رو که طرح میکنه آدم احساس میکنه یه مقدار فضای اندیشه های مارکسیستی اندیشه های کمونیستی تو اون روزگار در شعرش استفاده میشه که مثلا از زبان خون کارگر همین رو طرح میکنه. به خنده گفت میان من و تو فرق بسیست، توی ز دست شهی من ز پای کارگری. دو قطره خون دارن با همدیگه مناظره میکنن، خونی که از دست شاهی چکیده است و خونی که از پای کارگری چکیده است. برای همراهی و اتحاد با چومنی، خوش است اشک یتیمی و خون رنج بری. تو از فراغ دل و عشرت آمدی به وجود، با اون قطره خونی که از دست شاه چکیده است. من از خمیدن پشتی و زحمت کمری. این تقابل رو دقیقاً تقابل اجتماعی است و داره جامعه خودش رو ترسیم می‌کند.
مشکلاتی که برای مردم پیش می‌آمده، پروین همه اونا رو در شعر خودش تقریباً منعکس کرده، ولی به صورت کلی. شعری داره راجع به رنجبر و کارگر که من حالا چند بیتش رو براتون می‌خونم. تا به کی جان کندنن در آفتاب ای رنجبر، ریختن از بحر نان از چهره آب ای رنجبر، از حقوق پایمال خیشتن کن پرسشی، از حقوق پایمال خیشتن کن پرسشی، چند میترسی ز هر خان و جناب ای رنجبر، حاکم شرعی که بحر رشوه فتوا می دهد، کی دهد عرض فقیران را جواب ای رنجبر.
خانم پروین اعتصامی اولین شاعری بودند که به جنبه های گوناگون انسانی در شعر توجه کردند. یعنی ایشون هم نگاه به امور مادی و زندگی روزمره انسان داشتند و هم نگاه به مسائل اخلاقی انسانی و اون اموری که ما بیشتر بهشون به امور روحانی، به امور اندیشه و فکر غیر مادی در زندگی معمولا از اونها نام میبریم، به این جوانب هم در شعرشون توجه داشتن.
زبان مردم خودش هست، رنجهای جامعه خودش رو میبینه، همین رنجها هم بعدها برای او تنگناها، محدودیتها و دشواریهایی رو فراهم میآورد. در همون مقدمه دیوان پروین که در سال 1314 به چاپ رسیده، یعنی 6 سال پیش از مرگ پروین، ملک و شعرای بهار به این خصوصیت او اشاره می کند. البته عمدتاً به خصوصیات شعری و اسلوب شعری او، تأثیر شعر ناصر خسرو، تأثیر شعر حافظ، بهرهگیری از اسلوبهای کهن و شیوه های گذشته و به تدریج رسیدن به نوعی استقلال فکری و استقلال شعری اشاره می کند.
نکته تاریکی که در زندگی پروین وجود داره ازدواج او هست با فضل الله آرتا، همایون فال، که پروین در سن بالای 27 سال با فضل الله آرتا که پسر عموی پدری مرحوم پروین اعتصامی بوده و در اون زمان 42 سال سن داشته ازدواج میکنه. اونجور که آقای ابوالفتح اعتصامی دومین برادر پروین میگه، بیش از 2 ماه و نیم اونها دوام نمیاره ازدواجشون و پروین که به کرمانشاه رفته بود متارکه میکنه و به تهران بر میگرده.
Now a well-known figure, her divorce sparked rumor and gossip in newspapers and magazines around the country. She wrote a response in the intellectual Roshan Fekr magazine. The man she married was not illiterate or stupid. He was a police officer. The problem was his military stance, as opposed to her poetic character. Years later, in a letter to me, Parvin wrote, "My dear, a month after moving to Kermanshah, I found out that the man I was supposed to spend the rest of my life with was an opium addict." Any wrath from you is grace. To whoever you bring misfortune, it is a treasure. You are above all intellect. It is all what you ordered it to be. You place a person in darkness so they can see your shining face. If they come at me with an axe, they graft me with your grace. To whoever you give agony, you will heal at last. Whoever touches fatigue and distress did not know then they were your honored guests. Parvin E’tesami joined the Iranian Women's Foundation, hoping to be able to make steps towards the empowerment of women. When Parvin realized that the main concern of the Women's Foundation was to fight hijab, or the Islamic dress code, while women were still deprived of many of their basic rights in society, she decided to leave the foundation. After that, she always appeared in public with hijab. The head of the Women's Foundation, Badrul Muluk Bamdad, once said about Parvin, "She was aware of the injustice at play. And though we were proud to have her, she was always critical of the environment." Working at a government organization under the authority of the Shah's daughter may have been one of the many reasons Parvin felt uncomfortable at the foundation and decided to leave. In 1936, the library of the School for Advanced Studies hired her. It was a peaceful place and provided a wholesome environment for Parvin to immerse herself in literature and poetry. It was in that year that she was awarded the third degree honorary medal, which she did not accept. She also refused to teach the Queen and the heir to the throne at the request of Reza Shah, which angered him. Her poems against tyranny and her anti-government stance earned her many enemies. They used rumor and gossip against her. And when her father fell ill, after only 1 year, she resigned to take care of him. When her father passed away, Parvin dedicated her work to him, crediting his effort and support for her success. But his passing did not silence her, and she continued to criticize the government through her poems and literary work. 3 years and 3 months later, on the 24th of March 1941, while her brother was preparing to print the second edition of Parvin's work, she fell ill. The doctor diagnosed her illness as typhoid. However, he failed to treat her fast enough, and her condition deteriorated.
بر اثر تشخیص غلط و یا اهمالی که دکتر معین الحکما انجام میده، رفته رفته حالت پروین رو به وخامت میگذاره و متاسفانه
پزشکان هم وقتی خواستن برن و پروین رو آخرین لحظه ها ببینن، از اینکه پزشکان بر بالین او حاضر بشون اجازه ندادن.
در 15 روز در واپسین ساعت‌های اون روز پروین از دنیا میره.
وقتی تقاضای کالبد شکافی هم کردن، اجازه کالبد شکافی پروین رو ندادن و این اون حدس و قوی میکنه که پروین به سبب این روشنگری ها و این ایستادن در مقابل ظلم حکومت قربانی شده باشد.
مرحوم ابوالفتح اعتصامی در سال 1357، 37 سال بعد از فوت پروین، ماجرایی رو تعریف میکنه بدین صورت که میگوید پزشک خانوادگی ما دکتر معین الحکما بود و او اهمال کرد و به بالا سر پروین نیامد، هرچند مادر من بسیار عجز و لابه کرد.
I asked my physician friends about the cause of her death. They all said she died of typhoid, but they had refused to treat her. The cause of her death was plausible to many. For me, it will remain hazy and obscure. The government decision not to hold even one ceremony in memory of her life and work still astonishes me. Even the head of the Women's Foundation refused to hold a memorial for political reasons, making it clear that the government did not want her life to be remembered. It's more than a month since Parvin's death. I have written an article about it, but none of the newspapers have agreed to publish it. Whether the government had a hand in Parvin's death is still an unanswered question. Parvin was too young to die, but I am sure that her name will live on. During her short life, she managed to create a literary masterpiece that made her a household name. Her poems will no doubt continue to be admired for years to come. Woman has been the tree of life from the start. Who builds a house on hollow and weary pillars. If woman did not burn like a candle to your desires, none would have seen the end to this dark road. Like the sun, if she did not shine on the mountain, life could not bear the gem of love, the gem within the rock. Woman was an angel from the moment of creation. The angel that the devil envied. If Plato and Socrates were great, it was their childhood nurse, a child sleeping soundly in her mother's bed before learning wisdom at school and becoming wise.